Now, if I were to summarize where I see a lot of Korean companies in one word, I think it's boldness. We see a lot of boldness in Korean companies right now. And we see this in the mindset of the CEOs that McKinsey works with in Korea. And one of the fascinating things about this year is, despite all this uncertainty, the top inquiry that we get at McKinsey these days is around new growth. And it's around new growth in areas around energy and the transition. And we see that reflected in the actions that many of these Korean companies are taking. So one of the things that I'm inspired about is just the increased number of investments. In particular, for example, this year, in my 20 years that I've been in Korea, I've seen more cross-border activity from Korea outside than I've seen in a while. So for example, if you look at just recently, last few months, there was an announcement in Malaysia, a multi-billion dollar investment into carbon capture by six Korean companies. If you look at multiple joint ventures and investments in the United States and other places for battery technologies, if you look at some of the other outbound M&A that's happening, not just in sustainability, the level of investment that Korean executives are thinking about right now, I think it's quite inspiring and it's quite bold. And so what I see is that this is a time for Korean companies to really pull ahead. A lot of these technologies, for example, if you look at the battery business for many of these companies was not very profitable. And if you look at companies like LG, if you talk to them, they would say that this started many, many years ago. And for the first 10, 15 years, it wasn't a big business. But a lot of Korean companies have this long-term capitalism, long-term view, that at least allows it to pull ahead, make investments in technologies that, if you're driven by short-term earnings, if you're driven by short-term results, might not necessarily get you there. So I think this is a time for boldness, and we see this with many of our clients. We see this in the M&A, we see this in the investment in many of our clients. As many of people in Korea know, transitioning to net zero in Korea is probably one of the most ambitious goals in the history of Korea. This is probably one of the most biggest change in how Korea needs to source energy, but also make energy work in Korea. So as many people in Korea know, Korea is one of the largest polluters of carbon dioxide. We're in the top 10, depending on the ranking, we're about number 7 or 8, right behind Germany in carbon dioxide. It's because the Korean economy, as many people know, it's not as heavily services-oriented as other developed countries. We still have a very large base in industrial and in manufacturing sectors. Number two, industrial energy cost in Korea, it's still lower than many OECD countries. So it's roughly about 60% of the levels of the industrial energy of countries like Japan. Household energy is different, but the industrial energy in Korea is actually quite affordable by OECD standards. If you look at the actual use of energy, it's still predominantly 70-80% of it is still from fossil fuels. And Korea as a nation, while we are making bold moves in areas like solar and other renewables, our geography is just not great. We don't have flat land, we don't have deserts. Unfortunately, sunlight, we can't compete against geographies that have that advantage. So I think there is a big challenge ahead in Korea. And so if I look at where the innovations are happening in Korea to move to that transition, as I mentioned, carbon capture, if you can't stop the emission, can we at least capture it? I think that's one. I think the second area that a lot of Korean companies are looking at is hydrogen. So hydrogen is, for example, recently Korean companies announced $38 billion that they would invest into hydrogen technology. It's a consortium of Korean companies. And hydrogen can be used across multiple applications, not just in transportation. Of course, the challenge with hydrogen is you can actually emit carbon dioxide to create hydrogen. So how do we get green hydrogen? How do we get that from countries like Australia and Chile, where you can make hydrogen using solar and other renewable sources? How do you transport that to Korea? But hydrogen, carbon capture, I think these are some of the things that people are looking at. But it, frankly, I think this will be one of the most ambitious projects the country will be going on in the next 30 years. As many people have talked about, you know, the top Korean companies have been committing to RE100. But to get to RE100 in this country, it's going to take a colossal effort across private and public sectors here.